saints?
Good morning.
Everybody doing well?
Yes.
Wonderful. Nice to see a couple of visiting saints. I didn't see if they came marching in. Sorry, dad jokes will end. Yeah, that's a promise I can't fulfill, isn't it? Okay. How about a word from the song? It is good to praise the Lord and make what a delight it is to be together in your presence, that you invite us to join together and that you bless us by joining as well. As we prepare now to worship you, we ask you that your Holy Spirit would just anoint our hearts, our minds, our lips, that the gifts of praise and worship that we offer will honor you. And we ask you to come and inhabit those
praise for the things you do. It is good, it is good, it is good to give thanks to you. For though we struggle and trials and troubles still come our way, you won't forsake us. Your word has told us your promises will never end.
You have been good. Lord, we're overwhelmed by your goodness today. Your faithfulness higher than the heavens. In the face of our unfaithfulness, our short-term faithfulness, our short-sighted faithfulness, God, your faithfulness.
so you're not overwhelmed by it. You'll also learn how to survive holiday parties and get-togethers, how to handle loneliness, and you'll discover how you can gradually begin enjoying the holiday season again.
You make your plans, but then you always reserve the right to alter them.
What I decided to do was still have a party, but just change the way that I did it.
There's a difference between moving on and moving forward.
The Surviving the Holidays video features the wisdom and perspectives of
This one's a little bit different because we're actually advertising this on the Z88.3 events page. So this has the potential to really bring a lot of people from outside of the church in to help them with their grief over the holidays. So what I'm looking for is some volunteers to help, just kind of like greeters, to be at a registration table or cost to the church for getting the guides and everything that we will be handing out. So there's a lot of different opportunities to help out if you should feel so inclined. So if you are interested, then meet me after the service.
What time is it on the 12th?
Good question. It is December 12th at 10 a.m. It is a two-hour session. What I am not advertising, however, is if we do get a huge amount of people that have signed up, and if it's too many for COVID,
did you recognize Ken Henry's little song we had for offertory? I hope you did. It's from one of my favorite books in the Bible. Hezekiah, have you read it?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. It was from Habakkuk, chapter 3. And it's a great text that I love from that third chapter, but probably my favorite is at the beginning of that. And that is, O Lord, I've heard of your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds. Renew them in our day, in our time, make them known. In wrath, remember mercy. And then it was a cookout, and then we brought it indoors so it was an eat-out. I don't know what we'll call it now, but anyway, in lieu of that, we're doing dinner on the grounds today. We'll still do all praise and worship next week, but because of travel for Thanksgiving and the like, we thought maybe it would be better to do our meal today and then turn you guys loose to hit the road and do whatever you got to do. We have some traveling already. I know you're missing Alan and Betsy. Be praying for them. They should be in North Carolina already. Had a funeral of a close. big auction anymore. That helped us to raise a lot of money in previous years, but it also was a ton of work, and our workforce has dwindled on us over the years. So we discontinued that, and we spent time before just having our desserts in the fellowship hall and watching some great video and just letting you know what it costs to support the orphans that we're supporting over in India and hoping you'd give and that sort of thing. This week, this year, we decided we'd do another concert like we did a few act. If you'd get with Ken, that'd be spectacular. We could get some rehearsal done and figure out what our order will be, and it might actually flow. We'll just see. Got your Bibles with you? Let's take a minute and join in our weekly affirmation. I love this. It takes me a while to get up and be sure I'm up too, so don't have a fuss. Here we go.
Too late, huh?
All right, well, we're working in the book of James, and we've spent a few weeks looking at some of the themes in the first three chapters, written by James, the brother of Jesus, the de facto, everyone agrees, the leader of the church in Jerusalem, martyred in 62 AD, so one of the early books of the New Testament. Challenging the church for it's a tiny little part of the body, but oh, how powerful. My senior year in college, Sports Illustrated wrote an article about, wrote an article about college basketball. I was sort of interested in sports back then. I know that's probably hard to believe. My brother had a subscription, so I got a chance to read it. And so it was sort of you know, James is writing to a specific situation, and so he takes a lot of time to address the negative power of the tongue. But I just want to be careful as a sort of a postscript this week to say the Bible also addresses the incredibly powerful, positive value of the tongue, too. Words spoken in due season, wonderful, wonderful thing. So your tongue could be powerful. And obviously, in James's case, he's... today in chapter 4, and I'm just going to grab some highlights from 4 and a couple tidbits from 5 and act like we've handled the book of James. We have not, but we've hit some highlights at least, and so there it is. So chapter 4, verse 1 begins with, what causes fights and quarrels among you? Boom. Now, when James wrote this, or whoever collected it wrote it, they didn't separate it into chapters and verses. But for us, at least, the beginning of chapter 4 starts right off with, you guys. Fighting, there's quarrels going on, and James identifies those as a result of desires that are battling, that are raging. You have pretty much, he's saying, unchecked desires, and NG, no good, because when desires drive, rule, guide our lives. being in the world but not of the world. Some of us are both. And that's a challenge. So James tries to lay out for them, you need to get this. If you're going to be a friend of the world, you have declared yourself an enemy of God. The world being a colloquialism for the drivenness of the surrounding culture that's anything but about God. So, the world. When I was a kid growing up, I grew up in church, and so preachers would talk about the world. And the world. Enough to know whose quote it is?
Spurgeon.
How about Spurgeon? Not a lot changes, y'all. If he would say that in his day, how much more do you think he'd be underlining that in our day? It feels like more than ever the world has influence over the church. And sometimes it's because we're hanging on to our dual citizenship and emphasizing really strongly our church, the diaspora. We have to understand that friendship with the world is enmity with God. So he goes on to tell us this, then submit yourselves to God. Resist the devil, he'll flee from you. I want to just take a moment to grab that first bite because we've got too much in our mouth right there to chew. See, we get in trouble. We came to God and said, I have nothing to offer you, but I want to accept what you have to offer to me. I want to receive the gift of forgiveness of sins and eternal life. I want Jesus to come into my heart and reign so that I'm not subject to the power of the enemy all the time. So I don't have to be bound to my sinful. Yes? Return to your first love? Well, in our early days with God, we submitted ourselves to Him. And it's an important thing. Some versions, besides submit yourselves, end up saying these words: humble yourselves. Humble yourselves. Just want to sort of give you the benefit of some life experience. It's way better. Their place in the pew. Can I just say, if we knelt before God a bit more often, if our approach to Him was one of humbling ourselves, then an awful lot of stuff that's not going right in our world, in our body, in our lives, would be rooted right out. As it is, when we do not humble ourselves, and we don't submit ourselves to God, then the sinfulness that's a part of us starts taking some serious root. And I don't know about you, I can't stand weeding. I hate it. familiar with this passage, but it sort of makes it a little stark. God opposes the proud. Between you and me, I hope to never find that out in person, right? I don't ever want to find myself fighting against God. Do you remember Gamaliel? When he was advising that council there, the Sanhedrin, about what to do with these crazy disciples of Jesus, these early believers, he said, you know, we've seen this come and go before. Don't get all hardcore against them, because if they're fake, like all these others we've seen, they'll dry up and blow away. But if they're not, we'll be in the very unenviable position of opposing God, and we don't want to go there. Tells us God You know, when we talk about holy, 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 spoken three times for emphasis, how about God opposes the proud but shows favor to the humble, spoken three times for emphasis. It's a pretty big takeaway for us. So humble ourselves, and then some really good tidbits. How about resist the devil? It's so fascinating to me talking with folks who are overtaken by a sin, and to hear some folks describe it, they're just powerless. When I was a teenager, we used to listen to Flip Wilson telling us the devil made me do it, right? Me, I'm not strong enough for the storm. I lean over and whisper to him, I love your eggs. You know, it's important that we resist the devil. I'm sure this is a bit, well, these are apocryphal, likely stories, but we're told about Martin Luther that one time he threw an ink blot at the devil. Right? Another time, great story, he's in bed asleep, and he hears noise out in the living room area, gets up out of his bed to discover the devil in his living room. And his response was, oh, it's only you. I went back to bed. I'm going to apologize to all of you who did that and got punched in the nose. I'm sorry. But, you know, allegedly back in the days, the bullies would say, give me your lunch money or else. And at some point, smart ones finally go, or else what? Bring it, what do you got? And that's sort of the end of it, because it's all bluster, and very much the enemy of our souls wants to defeat us up here because he knows we have victory over him. So resist right. the devil, mm-hmm. and he will flee from you. And I love describing this little segment in James as a coin, because on heads it says, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. But if you call tails, always call tails, by the way. In statistics class, they talk about with a fair coin, no such thing. To him, worshiping. Because the enemy can't even know when that stuff's going on. He's got to go. So resist the devil, draw near to God. There's, of course, more to this whole deal, and I'm not going to break it all down. Anybody recognize this young man? I didn't know if anyone would. Now, I promise you, if I showed you a picture of him in your 20s, there'd be a half a dozen of you who would recognize the guy who was famous for recording this piece. That's Milam, if ever. And, you know, he was a Christian rocker, right? So our kids who just needed to rock and roll. So his brilliant lyric was, love God, hate sin. And the next day, and the next. But I will say, like the salesman who seems like they just don't ever take no for an answer, after a while they get a little tired of it. And so the intervals get a little bit longer and a little bit longer. Fight the fight. It's a daily battle. Step up to the plate every day. Tell them, yep, still not listening to you today. Still not buying your lies. Still not dancing to the song you want to play. I'm living for Jesus. It's a daily battle. Win that battle. wrap up with this, but James 5:16. It begins, by the way, with, is anybody needful? Pray and happy, let them sing. And sick, let them call for the elders and anoint them with oil, and the prayer of faith will save the sick. And then this fascinating treatment in James 5:16. Therefore, he says, confess your sins to each other. Ready to go. I don't think it matters what you wear, but we do read that he's from every tribe and tongue and people and nation. He's called us to be a kingdom of priests, yes. Well, what Martin Luther was driving at was, I don't need a go-between between me and God. I can go directly to him. And in the church, they have this little guy. I don't know if you're familiar with that. Anybody ever been in one of those processions? Oh, a bunch of us. Good. The seminary I attended was... do. and your sins would be forgiven. And that seems a little goofy to us Protestants. We realize that we confess to the Lord and we are forgiven for our sins. But can I just tell you this? There's something about hearing an audible voice that tells you that your sins are forgiven you, mm-hmm. that they are lifted from you, that God remembers them no more. That is incredibly freeing. And lots of us Protestants only confess to the Lord. Our vain pride would just be like the balloon, right? Going all over the room because we weren't secretive about stuff. And so I want to suggest to you that I think there's a nugget here in James 5:16 that if we, the church, were to follow it, wow, what a difference it would make in how we walk out our faith. Humility would kind of be a real deal. After having said that, James says, now pray for each other so that you may be healed. May be part of the answer here, that if we functioned more literally in conjunction with James 5:16, maybe we'd see a little more healing going on in our midst. Physical, spiritual, certainly, emotional. I think that would happen. And he ends with a powerful, powerful expression. I want everybody to go away knowing this today. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. We all can relate to somebody that we know that took prayer seriously. I just want to say, James makes really clear to us, and I want you to understand, while we see some giants and identify them as amazing people of prayer, James 5:16 is about you. Right? It's about you. God wants to answer your effective, fervent prayers. I think if there's a shortcoming, it's probably not on that answer. Similar to perhaps a jingle for a TV show when I was growing up. I don't know if you ever watched the show that began like this. Well, moving on down. Moving on down. You ever heard that? Because it's moving on up. That's what we think, but I just want to say with God, the way up is down. Mm-hmm. And as we hear that and practice that, humble ourselves, we'll discover that God is at work in our midst, in our lives, in ways we never dared to imagine. He will be exalted in our generation, and we'll tell of the goodness of God. Amen? Join me in prayer as we close. Thank you, Father, for the great love for us. Thank you that each one of us to move on down. In Jesus' name we ask, and we thank you in advance for hearing and answering our prayers. We ask you to just now to bless the food we're about to have. We pray that you'll use it to nourish our body. And we pray that as we sit together around tables and share our hearts with each other, that you will build your body among us.